Hey you guys, welcome to Children's Ministry Sunday Worship. Glad you're joining me here again today. Good to see you guys. I hope you guys had a wonderful week. So like we normally do, we're going to start our worship with prayer, right? We're going to make our right hearts right with God before we come to worship. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to confess any sins, right, that we didn't confess during the week, or like we remembered even this morning, right, something maybe we yelled at our parents, right? We want to confess that before God, and we want to make our hearts right with Him before we come and worship, right? And if you need to apologize to someone, go and apologize, right? That's part of this as well. So we're going to ask for forgiveness and lay our sins at His feet. Secondly, we're going to remember God's faithfulness and goodness to us. We're going to worship Him. We're going to thank Him for His goodness, right? Everything good that He's given us this past week, this morning, right, that you can think of, we're going to praise Him and thank Him for those things. And then lastly, right, we're going to ask God to teach us something new because He's speaking to us, right? He's always trying to speak to us. So we're going to ask Him to open up our ears and our hearts so that we can hear His message towards us today. All right. So I'm going to give you guys some time to pray on your own, and then I'll open us up in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful day. We thank you so much for this past week. And Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness towards us. We thank you for the many gifts that you have given to us, like our parents, teachers, the time that we have, right? The many toys and the games that we get to play. Lord, we thank you so much for these gifts. And would you help us to remember that you are the giver of gifts. Help us to love you more than the gifts that you give us. And Lord, forgive us for many times placing all these other things before you, placing ourselves before you, placing our parents and our friends, and even maybe sometimes our toys before you, Lord. Help us to put you as our number one, for you are the one and only true God who is worthy of all our worship and our praise. And at this time, as we come before you to worship God, would you open up our ears and our hearts so that we may hear the words that you want to speak to us today? We're here to listen to you. We're here to worship you. So we thank you for this time. Would you bless this time and be with us? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, let's stand up and have a time of praise.
Like sheep have gone astray, everybody wants to go their own way, but Jesus knows our every move, and He came to rescue me and you. Our God proves His love for us. Day.
All right, good job, you guys. So we're back in our series of the early church, right? And you know, during this early church period, a lot of Jesus's disciples wrote letters to the people to help them and encourage them. So today and in the next couple of weeks, we're going to look at the book of Hebrews. Okay, and this was a letter written to the early believers, right? And it was to help encourage them and also teach them of the truth. Okay, and so today we're going to be focusing on chapters 1 through 8, and the main point of these verses are to say, or to show the readers and the believers how Jesus is the greatest one of all. Have you guys ever heard the term GOAT? You know, the greatest of all times? Jesus is literally the greatest of all times, and so that's what we're going to learn today. So let's watch our video and read our verses.
The early church was made up of almost all Jewish believers who were persecuted for following Jesus. Because their lives had become difficult, many believers began to wonder if following Jesus was worth it. Some may have even thought about giving up on Jesus altogether. The Holy Spirit helped a Christian leader write words of encouragement to the early church in the book of Hebrews. He wrote, "Long ago, God spoke to his people through prophets. Now he speaks through Jesus. Jesus is God the Son, and he is like God in every way. Jesus is better than angels because he is God's Son, the eternal King and creator of everything who sits at God's right hand. But Jesus humbled himself to become lower than the angels for a time when he became a man. Jesus became a person like us, to die and then rise again. Jesus' work rescues people from sin. All who believe in him become his brothers and sisters. Jesus became like us in every way so he could become a merciful and faithful high priest for us. Because Jesus suffered and was tempted, he is able to help us when we are tempted. This is why Jesus is the greatest. He is greater even than Moses, who was a faithful servant of God. Jesus was an even better servant. God used Moses to bring the law to his people, but God used Jesus to bring the gospel. This is why we cannot turn away from Jesus. Instead, we need to encourage one another each day so that we don't give in to sin. We don't want to be like the Israelites who Moses led out of Egypt and then rebelled against God and perished in the wilderness. The Israelites wanted a land of rest, but even Joshua could not provide rest for God's people. We want to enter into God's rest, and Jesus has provided something even better than land, spiritual rest in Him. Because Jesus is such a great high priest for us, we can hold fast to our faith. Jesus knows our weaknesses because He became a human and was tempted, although He never sinned. Because of Jesus, we can approach God with boldness, and God will give us mercy and grace. This is why Jesus is better than anything, and why we cannot turn away from Him. The first covenant that God provided through Moses has been replaced by a second, better covenant through Jesus. Salvation is found only in Jesus. Jesus is better than anyone and anything. He is the better prophet, the better priest, and the better king. Everyone who trusts in Jesus has salvation from sin through His perfect life, death, and resurrection.
All right, you guys. So we're going to read two sections out of Hebrews 1 through 8. So the first one comes from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. So let's read this together. Ready? Begin. We have a great high priest. He has gone up into heaven. He is Jesus, the Son of God. So let us hold firmly to what we say we believe. We have a high priest who can feel it when we are weak and hurting. We have a high priest who has been tempted in every way just as we are, but he did not sin. So let us boldly approach God's throne of grace. Then we will receive mercy. We will find grace to help us when we need it. The next verses are from Hebrews chapter 8, verses 1 through 6. So let's read this together. Ready? Begin. Here is the main point of what we are saying. We have a high priest like that. He sat down at the right hand of the throne of the King, the Majesty in heaven. He serves in the sacred tent. The Lord set up the true holy tent. A mere human being did not set it up. Every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. So this priest also had to have something to offer. What if he were on earth? Then he would not be a priest. There are already priests who offer the gifts required by the law. They serve at a sacred tent, but it is only a copy and shadow of what is in heaven. That's why God warned Moses when he was about to build the holy tent. God said, "Be sure to make everything just like the pattern I showed you on the mountain." But Jesus has been given a greater work to do for God. He is the go-between for the new covenant. This covenant is better than the old one. The new covenant is based on better promises. Amen. So you know, in the past, God had appointed many leaders, right? Many priests, many kings, right? Many prophets, right? And remember, what the prophets did was they communicated between the people and God, right? He was God's messenger, and even sometimes the messenger for the people to speak to God, right? They had a prophet. And then, right, God would appoint certain leaders like Moses, or before Moses was like Abraham, right? Moses and Joshua. And so he would raise these leaders who would lead his people. And then later on, he would raise kings like King Saul, King David, right? And so he would raise these people. And these leaders, these prophets, would help connect the people to God. And then he also raised priests, right? And these priests, what they would do is they would lead the people into worship to worship God. They would also, you know, give message to the people. They would also offer sacrifices to God for the people's sins, right? And only these priests were also able to enter this Holy of Holies, right? The sacred area where they would make these sacrifices. Not anyone can go in there, only these priests. After they went through some cleansing rituals, then they were able to enter into this holy space where they could speak to God or even make these sacrifices unto God, right? Remember, when Jesus died on that cross, there was a curtain in the temple that was split in half, right? And that curtain separated the holy area of God and where the people can be, right? Not anyone can enter. But after Jesus died and he said, "It is finished," that curtain split open so that anyone can see into the holy area of God. So God was saying, now you can just enter and come and be with me because of what Jesus did, because he got rid of our sins. He paid the price for our sins. Okay? So that's why in the text that we read, this high priest, right? In Hebrews, it says that we have a high priest who understands us. And this high priest is the one who would make these sacrifices. And Jesus, he made the ultimate sacrifice, which was himself, right? He gave up himself, his body, and paid the price of the sin. Because in the past, they would use animals to make the sacrifice unto God, asking him to forgive our sins. And this animal would pay the price of the people's sins. But Jesus, he sacrificed himself. And that was the ultimate and last sacrifice. That's why he is the greatest high priest. And not only is he the sacrifice, but he also understands us because he lived on this earth. So he is better than any earthly priest because he, right, was the ultimate sacrifice and he was perfect, unlike these imperfect human priests who would make the same mistakes, who would need to make a sacrifice for their sins. Jesus was not like that, right? And Jesus, even though he was perfect, he does not look down on us and say, "Why can't you just, you know, stop doing that? You know, why can't you just stop sinning? You know, why can't you not do that? Why do you keep getting tempted?" He doesn't act like that towards us. He understands when we get weak, when we get tired, when we get tempted, because he went through the same things. He understands us. And so he is the middleman between us and God, the ultimate middleman between us and God. And so he speaks to God, and he is kind of like, you know, when you have a lawyer, the lawyer like talks to the judge about your side, right? And so there's the lawyers say, "This person is innocent because blah 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 blah," right? And so Jesus is kind of like that. He's that middleman. And he goes up to God and he says, "God, we forgive this person because I paid for the price of their sins." He's our middleman. We no longer need some human being to make a sacrifice for us and say, "God, please forgive us." No. We go straight to God. We go straight to Jesus and say, "Jesus, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me of my sins. I'm going to repent. I am repenting of my sin." And Jesus says, "Okay." And he talks to God and says, "Remember, I paid for that sin." Then God says, "It is forgiven." So he is the greatest high priest. Better than any earthly priest, better than any earthly leader that the Israelites had, right? Because he was perfect. And he is not dead, right? He rose again. He is alive. So we don't speak to a dead God. We speak to a God that is alive, sitting at the right hand of God right now, right? And so through Jesus, he brings us a new covenant to live by. This covenant is a promise in the long time ago, the Israelites made a covenant with God saying, we promise, right, to follow you. Right? God said, you promise to follow me, then I promise to be your God, to protect you, to give you all that you need. And in this covenant, he gave them, you know, laws, how to live their lives, also rules on how to do the rituals and the sacrifices for their sins or for anything that they have done, right? He gave them all these rules. But Jesus, he gets rid of all that, right? Because that's the old covenant. That's the old promises he made with the Israelites. And now Jesus said, I've paid the price of people's sins. And now all you need to do is follow after me. Believe in me. Make me your Lord and Savior. And now you have a way to God. You don't need to make all these sacrifices. You don't need to talk to someone to ask for forgiveness for your sins. That's a human. You just come and pray. And I am there with you. God is right there with you. He's easy access now. We can talk to him anytime, anywhere. We can confess our sins to God anywhere and anywhere. And he will hear us. And he will forgive us because of what Jesus did on that cross. So we are saved from our sins. We have a new life through Jesus Christ. He is the greatest of all times. Right? Remember I said that? He is the GOAT, right? The greatest of all times. Because he is not like any earthly leader that we have or that the Israelites had. Because even those earthly leaders the Israelites had were not perfect. They made mistakes. They sinned just like any other human being. But Jesus, he lived the perfect life. He was the perfect sacrifice. And now when we just speak to Jesus, our sins are forgiven. There is no crazy ritual we need to do or sacrifice an animal. We no longer need to do that. All we need to do is go to Jesus. And that's why he is the greatest of all times. All right, guys, let's end with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right, guys. I hope you guys have a wonderful week. Stay safe. Go out, enjoy the sun, and I'll see you guys again next time.